Good evening to everyone. Everyone has got a program on there where they have read that the topic is what things change and nobody tells you. So
change the title.
We didn't tell anyone. I grew up in South Africa during apartheid era. And during that time, and apartheid, for those people that don't know, and even for those people that do know, was a system that segregated people based on the color of your skin. And it forced you to, it forced this on you, and it made you the type of person that could only live in certain places, and shop in certain places, and therefore eat certain things, go to certain types of schools. And the quality of education degraded based on the color of your skin. And the whole world banded together to get South Africa to get rid of this horrible system of apartheid and to live an equal and opportune life. When I left South Africa in 2001, the official stance from the government was apartheid is abolished. What stayed behind was public sentiment, because you grew your whole life thinking that you were right in treating somebody in a certain way. But that public sentiment stayed with people, and it's not something that could get rid of very easily. We moved to the island in 2001. Like I said, for us it was a new start. We had a young family, and everything was going to be nice and new. We had a new place with some new fancy climate, new foods, new opportunities, new jobs. The kids had new schools, new friends, new cereals, new sweets, and new types of milk, and new types of everything. And it just became really, really overwhelming that there's so much of new stuff going on. And we were really fortunate, as practicing Muslims, we were really fortunate to find that the Isle of Man already had an Islamic community with a mosque. And for us, this gave us some sort of link back to something that is familiar, which is our religion and our Islam. On the island, we found that the Islamic diversity was far greater than we even experienced in South Africa. We had people from all over the world, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Sudan, Pakistan, India, South Africa, and from all over the world, all Muslims practicing on the island. And Islam, like any other religion, manages to cross boundaries and cross borders. And we found that on the island, there were people that were well-traveled, that had a good understanding of Muslims and Islam in general, and the practices and principles that you lived your life by. And then there are a lot of other people on the island that were still very new to Islam and didn't quite understand what it was like to be a Muslim or to live your life governed by a set of Islamic rules and principles. And for us it was great. We could have really interesting conversations, explain to people about our religion and things that we held true and close to our heart, and to go to schools and explain to them why we didn't celebrate Christmas, but we did two Eids, which basically meant we had to give our kids twice as many presents in the year. And it was interesting to see that evolution, because we had people looking at us with interest about wanting to learn the religion and learn about Islam and learn about what it's like to be a Muslim. And unfortunately, in September of that year, September 2001, was a point in time where the entire world changed. I'm not going to go into details. We all know what happened on September 11th. I'm not here to condone the actions of people that committed those crimes and those atrocities, no matter which way we look at it, whether it was based on religious affiliation or some sort of fanaticism, or based on retaliation, or based on the fact that people just want to hate against whoever they thought was doing these crimes and these actions. In during this time, it as Muslims, even leaving aside Muslim, but as a human being, we felt the sorrow that the whole world felt. We saw all of these atrocities going on around us, and we felt the hurt and the pain for all of the life that was being lost and the property that was being damaged. And after a while, it became very apparent, based on the fact that this 24/7 media showed you everything that was going on, showed you all of the what that was happening, and eventually turned on to the who. And the who that they painted a big picture against was Islam or Muslim. And we noticed after a little while that suddenly our sorrow didn't matter. It didn't matter that I felt hurt for somebody else's pain. That didn't matter at all. In December of that year, for anybody that's moved over from South Africa, you'll know that you have to get a return ticket. So in December of that year, we're flying back to South Africa, and we did the same as everyone else. Figured out how to get the kids into the taxi in the morning, fly off to Manchester in the evening for a connecting flight next morning from Manchester to Amsterdam, connecting flight down to Johannesburg, South Africa. And during this time, there was heightened security, which was great, because we just came to September 11th. We're in the December period, which is a holiday period, and it's understandable that everything's going to be heightened and increased. Everything took longer to get through, the check-ins took longer, but we didn't mind, because we wanted to be safe as well as everybody else. And we didn't think anything of it, but like we normally do, whenever we book our flight, we order a Muslim meal. And for some weird reason, it's always chicken curry and rice. And we did the same meal, we ordered a Muslim meal, 4 up please, and we didn't think anything of it. So we got into the flight, and immediately my wife and I noticed what we could only describe as utter silence throughout the entire aircraft. Everyone turned and looked at us with shock and horror. My wife has a headscarf, and so they immediately knew we were Muslim. As we tracked our way down the corridor to get to the carriage to put our hand luggage in, we noticed, or you could feel the eyes looking at you, tracking you all the way through. But we were on holiday, we didn't care. We went home to see Gran, and the kids were all happy and had their party packs, and we had them sat down. And halfway through the flight, it's mealtime, starving, waiting for airplane food. And he came over, and fair enough, yes, it was chicken curry and rice, but there was something different this time around. And eventually it dawned on me, the cutlery that we were given was plastic. And I immediately thought, man, this is a really great security feature. I mean, you can't have people running around in planes with metal cutlery, especially not what happened September 11th. I'm sure this is, and I stopped immediately because the guy right next door to me had metal cutlery. And so I thought, maybe it's just me, maybe they ran out. So I looked over at my wife, and she had plastic cutlery as well. Looked over to the kids, and they had the same as well. And I'm a technologist, and sort of logic plays a big part of my life. So I said, well, let's conduct a survey. So I decided at that point to go to the bathroom to conduct my survey. And as I walked through the corridor, and metal cutlery, plastic. And now I met another Muslim person on the flight. And I know profiling doesn't exist, but this was our first introduction to it. But you try to live your life, you try to forget about these things that happen, you try to live your life and go on, you want to teach your kids good values, and you want to impress on them the importance of being good people, and especially from a religious perspective. You give them the theory behind it, you teach them the history of the religion, and you also try to be a good example for them to follow their religion and to do their practices. And it becomes difficult because you're fighting against this media engine which is pointing a finger at you or your religion. And it's a very difficult day when your kid comes home one day and says, am I a terrorist? And after a few months, we had a really terrible incident again, September 7th, the London bombings. And at the time, I was working down in Castletown. And I used a bus to travel to Castletown to Douglas. It's not a very exciting journey, but it became part of my routine. Every day that I got on the bus, to walk in, make sure that people looked at me and saw me coming in, because I had a backpack on every day, carrying my computer, nothing else. And made sure that whenever I sat down, I opened up my bag, took out my MP3 player, took out a pack of crisps, ruffled it around to make sure people looked down at me, had a look in my bag to see that it was all clean, closed it back up, MP3 player in my ears, and headed back off to the journey down to Douglas. And we, as Muslims, you kind of gotten used to the fact that you're going to be randomly selected for one of our routine checks. So we're not profiling you, but we just randomly managed to pick you out of the crowd again. And sometimes it got stupid. My daughter was on a school trip. Isle of Man was kind enough to fly them on a school trip to Canada, but a stopover in the US. And during that time, the US immigration officer pulled her out of the light and started questioning her and asked her one of what we still think is the stupidest question ever from an immigration officer. And the question was, why were you born on this date? Her birthday is September 11th.
Oh, dear.
And so again, you know, as parents, you want our children to have a good life, to learn the values of Islam and to promote their religion, to grow and understand understand who they are and become part of your society, your own community. And you do that yourself. You know, try and build who you are, build your business. And I've said this earlier, but I'll say it again, we shamelessly plug it every chance we get. Try and be part of a community and contribute to the community in which you live in. Be part of a personal growth in your own community. And you think you're doing well, and sometimes things happen, and of course the media points a big picture about who's doing what, and as far as Islam's concerned, they're always portrayed as the bad guys, not only in the papers, but in movies and cinema. And you get to a point where maybe you become thick-skinned about it. But sometimes you feel you're doing really, really well in your community, and you find out that your community finds out about a mosque that might exist on the island. Which, remember, we moved over in 2001, the mosque was already here. These extracts that you see from here right now are from a Facebook post, June this year onwards. And you think you're doing well in the community, and you see responses like this based on the fact that people have this idea or this perception of Islam. You, as Muslims and as other Muslims in this world, we stand up openly on social media and we try to impress to the public or those people around us that people that are committing these crimes and these atrocities are not considered Muslim. We shouldn't have to stand up and voice our opinion about why they're not Muslim, but they are not considered Muslim. And as far as a practicing Muslim goes, these are our actions the Islamic actions that we perform every day are part of our culture, part of our life, and part of our religion. It's what gets us through from day to day. And knowing that we have a community on this island that sometimes may be misinformed, uneducated, or have their will pulled over the eyes is an eye-opener. I'm a very big part of our Islamic community. I'm a very big part of other communities on the island, both at work and in my playtime, whichever was decreasing. But there are a lot of bridges that we still need to cross, and there's still a lot that needs to get done. And I'd like to invite anybody that wants to learn a little bit more to come and talk to me about it. I'm very open about Islam, and I don't want it to have a negative impact on our island, because it's for anybody that's growing up as a Muslim on this island, it becomes really challenging. There isn't anywhere else that children can focus as far as Muslim children go, as well as non-Muslim children. They need a place to understand what Islam is about. So if anybody would like to, you're welcome to come and have a chat. And my topic for today is on labels. I didn't start off with introducing myself, but I am Zakir Hoosen. I'm a Muslim Manxman, originally born and bred in South Africa, with grandparents from India. That's as far back as I can go. Thank you.